Looks like it's working. At least it's doing something.
Hi everyone, welcome back to Cody's Lab. So in today's video, I want to try making a metal that is used in everything from pop cans to airplanes. And I want to try sourcing it from natural materials that I can dig out of the ground on the ranch. And that metal is aluminum. Now the only problem with that is I live here in the Great Basin and most of our rocks here are limestone. Now in order to form an ore that I could easily extract aluminum from, I'm going to have material that started off as being granite or another feldspar containing rock. And then that rock must be weathered, chemically weathered, by acidic rainwater for a very long time. Eventually that would turn into clay. Now we do have materials here that resemble clay. You go down to the Great Salt Lake, you got that sticky material that everyone calls clay, but it's really not clay, because if you try to make bricks out of it and then fire it, it'll fall apart because, once again, it's made mostly of lime. And lime breaks down when you heat it. It's just not the right material. Same particle size, that's why it feels the same, but it's not clay. And even if we do have sources of clay here, the problem is then that clay is not really the thing we're looking for because it contains way too much silica. It does have a lot of aluminum in it, but clay is formed from aluminum silicates. And you really need something that has a very high concentration of aluminum, otherwise it's not worth your time to extract. Now, in order to go from clay to a material that's higher in aluminum, you've got to continue to weather it and leach that silica out with more and more rainwater. Now, you're going to need a flat surface, warm temperatures, and a lot of time. And that usually does not happen this far north. It usually happens in the tropics. That's why most mines that produce the raw materials for aluminum are down in the tropical regions. So in order to get some material that I can actually process and extract the aluminum from, I'm going to have to find something with the highest aluminum content that I can. And so I've come up here to one of my mining claims. You see, up here in the distance, you can see the rocks up there. They're kind of covered in snow, but there's a little bit of a twist in the rocks. That's because there's actually a fault there. It's a thrust fault. It goes up like this, and that actually happened before these mountains formed. So that fault's not really active anymore. The mountains have since risen up, and the rocks have moved around since, but that fault is still there. And that fault was active for millions of years. Old faults like this tend to contain large concentrations of minerals, and that is why there's a mine right here. The mine was dug directly into the fault. You can see the fault right there. You've got some bioturbated silica-rich limestone here. That's chert nodules in the limestone. And over here, we have shale. There's a little bit of sandstone right here, interbedded with shale. Now, shale was actually laid down in a tropical region. In fact, the limestone was as well. 500 million years ago, this was a shallow sea. And we had water coming off of mountains which were granaceous. And they contained all the materials to create these rocks. The carbonates were pulled out of the water by marine animals, and when they died, their skeletons piled up, forming the limestone. But any clays that were washed into the sea settled down to form shale. Now you may know something about shale, and that's that it's very flaky. See how I can just pull it apart by my hands? It's very soft, flaky, and it's in sheets. And what happens is when the clay packs down on the bottom of the sea, it squeezes the water out and the aluminum silicate sheets line up with each other and form these flaky shale rocks. Now, if you weather shale, you react it with water, once again, it's fairly easy to turn back into clay. In fact, many places that do produce brick, especially here in the western United States, usually start with shale. They spread it out so the water can get to it, and they form clay. Now here, because this is a fault line, a lot of water is actually able to get to the shale, and so clay is formed rather rapidly. And it's also ground up by the motion of the earth. But there's one more thing. The water here is acidic, and so the clay is also weathered even further. Okay, so here we are. The moisture content in here is kind of high, so it may fog up the camera. But if we look up here, you can actually see the fault and where material has fallen down from it. Now this material here that is broken up by the fault is called gouge. And since we are in a section of this where a lot of the gouge contains shale, the shale is actually weathered into this clay material here. Now I've actually done some tests on this quite a while ago. We had an assay done on it, and the aluminum content of this was quite high, higher than most clays that I've ever seen, in fact. That's because this clay has sit in here for millions of years, and groundwater has flowed through this fault, acidified by minerals in the rock, and has further weathered the clay into something which is as close to bauxite as I could probably possibly find. So clay is comprised of aluminum silicate, but when the silica is weathered out, now this does take a long time because, as you may suspect, glass bottles do not dissolve in water very quickly. But the aluminum oxide is far less soluble than even the silica, so over time the silica is preferentially weathered out, leaving behind the aluminum oxide. Let's grab us a nice sample of this. I think this one would be nice. Let's go home and see if I can get the aluminum out. Okay. Shouldn't have poured hot water there last time. So, here's my sample of clay here. Now, I need to crush this up and make a slurry in order to do any useful chemistry with it. So, let's wrap it in a rag and smash it with a metal brick. Okay. Now I have clay powder, which I will now mix with some warm water to dissolve it into a slurry. This step is mostly to get out the large pieces of rock and other contaminants that are not clay. Just slowly pour this out, and I'll leave the bottom portion in place. As you can see, that's mostly gravel and sand. So now I've got a slurry of clay in my bucket. So the elements I have here listed by mass are oxygen, silicon, aluminum, hydrogen because it's mostly water, and then you've got your trace elements such as iron, titanium, magnesium, etc. Now industrially, the way that they isolate the alumina is to dissolve everything in hot, concentrated lye solution. The sodium hydroxide dissolves both the alumina and the silica, but not the iron and some other elements. The only problem is that alumina is only soluble in sodium hydroxide at very high temperatures, around 200 degrees Celsius. In order to achieve that, I would have to seal it and pressurize the mixture. That process, for me, is going to be a little bit inefficient, and to be honest, I've got enough people calling the ATF on my behalf saying that I've been making pipe bombs. So rather than that, I'm going to just empty this into this crock pot here so I can get it out of the leaky bucket. And then I'm just going to add in some hydrochloric acid. Now hydrochloric acid will dissolve the alumina. It will not dissolve silica. Unfortunately, the hydrochloric acid will dissolve iron and possibly the titanium as well, but they'll be in concentrations that's low enough for me to deal with. So let's just put a bunch of that in there, and I'm going to plug in this crock pot and heat it up for a little while until the alumina has had a good chance to dissolve into the hydrochloric acid. Now that this has had some time to cook, I'm going to remove this lid, and I'm going to pour most of this off, especially this semi-clear liquid at the top, into this other jug. Now, what I should have in the liquid is a dilute solution of aluminum chloride and apparently some hydrochloric acid. Oh, come on! And what's left in here should be primarily the silica, and there might be a little bit of aluminum left. If there was any crystalline aluminum oxide, the hydrochloric acid would have a hard time dissolving it. So I added a little bit of extra water to this to help it wash out the aluminum chloride. As you can see, the material here is a lot lighter in color. That's because the hydrochloric acid has dissolved away
a lot of the iron.
So now that this is settled out a little bit, let's open this jug back up and let's pour off this clarified solution into this glass over here. So now I should have primarily aluminum chloride, a little bit of iron, and whatever else the hydrochloric acid dissolved. Maybe magnesium and stuff. Probably not a whole lot of titanium, but that's also a possibility. Now to my orange juice looking fluid, I'm gonna add in a little bit more lye. This will neutralize the hydrochloric acid, making the solution more alkaline. And then what'll happen to the aluminum chloride is it'll precipitate from solution as aluminum hydroxide. So I think we're getting somewhere. I think I'm very close. You can see a brownish mud forming. And if I pull some of this out of there, yes, it is a gelatinous material. That looks like aluminum hydroxide to me. It looks like it is contaminated with stuff. The green coloring, I'd say, is probably the iron. It's gonna be kind of hard to get rid of all that iron, and it's not too bad. I can still work with it, I think. Fortunately, iron hydroxide is roughly 7,000 times more soluble than aluminum oxide, so I could pretty easily separate the two just by rinsing with copious amounts of water. So let's stir this in, let it settle, and repeat. So this is what I'm left with after washing several times in water. This is my aluminum hydroxide here, and it is very goopy still, and there's not a whole lot here, but there we go, that's my product. Now I gotta dry this out and heat it up to 1,000 degrees Celsius to calcine it and remove all of the moisture, all of the hydrogen from it, leaving me with pure aluminum oxide or alumina. Let's get the furnace out.
All right, so I've got it in a graphite crucible here. Tip it out, and there, presumably, is my alumina.
Here's a little bit better shot of my aluminum oxide. Yeah, feels about right. This would be a good polishing compound here, because it's in a fine powder, but it's also a very hard material. Yeah, all right. So now, I think I'm gonna use electrolysis, just like they do industrially, to produce the pure aluminum metal.
Yeah, starting to snow on me. So you might be aware that aluminium oxide like this has a very high melting point, and in order to do electrolysis on it, I'm going to have it in a liquid state. Now to do that, I'm going to mix it with some cryolite. This material here is sodium aluminum fluoride. This is a naturally occurring mineral, but it's so rare that the only samples of it I've ever seen was in a museum, so I had to buy this. But it's pretty easy to make if you have hydrofluoric acid. You just react the hydrofluoric acid with the aluminum oxide. And what this does is it's going to mix with the aluminum oxide, lowering the melting point to something that I can actually handle. Now the cryolite really isn't used up in the reaction. It can be recycled over and over again, so I'm not really too worried about buying it like I did. So here's the plan. I have this fajita pan here, hooked to the negative electrode, and I've got the positive electrode to this carbon rod here. As you can see, they conduct electricity. I've got it hooked to a 6-volt, 40-amp source, but I can change that if I need to. Now, for the gases that are going to be produced from this reaction, you're probably primarily going to have oxygen and carbon dioxide, and the carbon is going to come from the rod as it reacts with the oxygen. Now there's also the potential to form carbon monoxide as well as hydrogen fluoride, so that's why I've got this fan here blowing the air away. All right, so let's pull this out and see if we can do it. Looks like it's molten. It's a good sign. Okay, push it up down. There's the electricity. It doesn't seem to be producing much of a reaction. I see the problem is I'm not... Let's turn up the current. Yeah, it looks like my carbon rod is just cooling the cryolite to it. It's not actually getting good electrical contact there, so I'm going to have to try this again. Maybe I have to preheat the rod. So this time I've preheated everything in the furnace. You see the rod is now red hot. Let's see if I can get a hold of this without causing an arc. All right, looks like it's working. There we go. That's the way. Pull this camera in a little closer, I guess. Looks like it's working. At least it's doing something. I put the electricity through it for quite a while. Presumably there might be some aluminum metal in there, but let's put it back in the furnace and melt this all up once again, and then I'll pour it out and see what I've got after several days worth of work. That's not good. Ah, there's some shiny bits. Okay. There's definitely a little ball of something right there. Let's set this aside for now. Looks like there might be some more little balls inside of the slag. The biggest one's right here. There it is. That looks like a shiny piece of metal to me. Oh man, it actually worked. Obviously I didn't make very much, but that's something. Here's my two beads of metal. You can see they're quite shiny and they feel very light. And that is just more confirmation that this is indeed aluminium. That's awesome. I actually was able to pull it off. Who else do you know has made aluminum from scratch at home? That's awesome. So, hope y'all enjoyed. I'll see you next time.
So today I want to try making aluminum, otherwise pronounced as aluminium, or how I will try to from now on, aluminum, just to mess with everyone. Now, aluminum is a very reactive material. It loves to bind together with oxygen. That's why thermite is so energetic. So in order to extract it, it's very difficult, even though it's one of the more common minerals in the Earth's crust. However, not in my area, unfortunately. You see, the rocks behind me are calcium carbonate. They were put down at the bottom of a shallow sea back in the Mississippian era from corals and stuff.